I sign up. $3 is like a cup of coffee.
At Star, actually, it's not even a cup of coffee. You can't even buy a cup of coffee with $3. So, do it. It's going to a great cause. Actually, you know what? Do I have $20? I have $20. Look, I'm leading by example, guys. $20 in there. It's not fake. It's real. That's all of my Dunkin' Donuts money for the week. Let's go. No, do it. I'll make it a competition. Dang, he beat me. All right, guys. Well, listen, tonight, as you guys know, Avalanche, we always do this after Avalanche. We do the same thing after summer camp. I was a little nervous because I was like, man, 42 students went to Avalanche, and I can't have... Yeah, by the way, that was awesome. We had the greatest amount of students there. It was great. We were the biggest group. Literally, like, if you talk to one person, if you talk to five people, you had a 1 in 5 chance to talk to one of our students. It was pretty awesome. It's pretty great. I felt so proud of you guys. You guys were awesome. You guys were, like, stellar students. I didn't have to worry about a single thing. All of my leaders said how great you guys were. I didn't have a single problem with any of you. So that is awesome. I want to publicly thank Aiden for coming out on his first trip with a... Yeah. He did awesome. He did awesome leading some of these young guys. Right, guys? Junior high. How did he do? He was awesome, right? Yeah. They're like dabbing. Anyways, but tonight I want to do something that we're in tradition of doing, and I don't think that doesn't matter how big we'll get. I think that we're always going to do this because this is part of our DNA. It's part of who we are, and we like sharing, and we want to know what God did in some of you guys' life. For some, it might be just like, you know what, I had an awesome time, and I hung out with people, and I got to meet some awesome Christians. For others, it might be like, dude, I got saved, and the Lord just really, like, wrecked my life, and I gave my heart to the Lord, and I wasn't saved, now I am, and I'm living 100% for Him. So, listen, whatever it was, all right, guys, whatever it was, whatever God did in your life, whatever awesome thing you have to say, I want you to come up, and I want you to share it, not all at once. We're going to raise hands, don't worry. But this is why I want to do it. I want to do it for two reasons. You ready? Go like this. Two. Two. No. Yeah, old man. Get something new. Get something new. So, dude. I know. It's actually all over the internet, so. But listen, guys, two reasons. The first reason is I want to get you guys to be fearless on the state, on the platform. Fearless. Like, I don't believe in fear, okay? Like, if somebody tells you it's okay to be afraid, don't believe them. It's not okay, all right? But seriously, I want to get you guys to be fearless on the platform. I don't care for what. I don't care if you're receiving an award at school, right, and you have to go up there and speak. Like, I want you guys to know how to do it. But not only that, I also, like, it builds this unity that we have. We have one of the, believe it or not, we have one of the most united youth groups that I have personally ever seen, and that, like, some of my youth pastor friends say we have. So if they're saying it, I'm saying it, you guys are saying it, it must be true. So we have, and then it helps, some of the reason that we have that is because we have a testimony, and we share each other's stories with one another. So listen, your story matters. It matters to me, and it matters to the people around you. Look around and say, yes, your story matters. Your story matters. What you have to say matters, okay? So I'm gonna invite you guys, and the first person always has to be the bravest because they have to just do it. The first speaker. Sure, come on up. Sure, come. You have to come on up right now. Yeah, give it up for Lily Zuskin. Can I have this mic turned on, please? I think it's on, right? It's on? All right, Jordan, you're the man, dude. Didn't even have to ask.
All right. So, some of you may know, I didn't get to go to Avalanche because I sprained my ankle. And, all right, so the way I did it was I was actually Snapchatting one of my friends and walking because they changed my bus stop. So I had to walk to my house. And I was actually Snapchatting a friend that I was actually so excited to go to Avalanche. And then because of a klutz that I am, I fell in a mud puddle and I didn't get to go. I sprained my ankle. I got very upset. I actually cried, like, the entire time. because I never, like, you know, because I am one of, like, the younger people here, and I never got to go to camp. So, you know, it really hurt because I just, I don't know. I packed my bag, and I was ready to go. And unpacking it was probably, like, the hardest part because when you're unpacking, like, you know, you, most of you guys unpacked after you got this, like, wonderful experience and, like, I don't know.
I'm sorry. I did offer to throw you in a backpack and carry you all weekend. I did. Yeah. I actually offered. I told you that. I was like, I will carry her on a backpack in my bag.
Yeah, it just, it sucks. So, like, I don't know. I'm just ready for camp. Like, I'll pack now. Like, I don't know. I just remember, like, last year when, like, the kids, the people who came home, like, they came here, and then at Jackson School, they all share their experience, and I was just like, you know what? I'm ready for Avalanche, and now, because of this, I was just like, no. But then, like, over, like, the time that I did this, like, I just, like, felt God speak to me, like, it's okay, like, there's going to be tons of experiences that you're going to have with me, and I was just like, I can't wait.
Receive it. Mm.
I can't wait. Like, you know. So, like, I'm going to be careful. So I can go to
just
camp.
Just don't Snapchat. Just throw your phone out the window.
No, like, I was even Snapchatting that I was ready to go to camp. Like, I was, like, it was about Avalanche. And, like, you know, I was just, it really sucks.
That stinks. That really stinks. Well, listen, Lily, I want to tell you that we are excited to go on a trip with you. We're excited that you're part of the Forge. And you mean a lot to us. So when I found out, we did. We really did. When I found out that you weren't coming, like, I was like, I'll put her in a backpack and I'll just carry her. And but it really was sad. Yeah, we figured out a way. But seriously, listen, we're excited for we have convention coming up, we have youth camp, we have fine arts, we have a lot of different things, so make sure you sign up for some of those things. But last thing, I just want to tell you, listen, I'm so excited that you're part of a youth group. I remember when you were in children's ministry and then you became a helper and then you started coming here. So this is just the beginning. This youth group loves Lily, right? What's up? All right, guys, give it up for Lily real quick. Don't fall and hurt the other one. All right, do we have anyone else that would like to share some of the awesome things that happened at Avalanche? Yes, Jonah, come on up. Oh, sorry. Oh, I have him up there. Ooh, somebody brought me food. Thank you, I appreciate it. Ooh. What? What do you mean? Sorry. Thank you. I'm going to have it. Thank you. I appreciate it. I will enjoy it. Okay. All right. Here, Tony. Here you go. Thank you. Appreciate it for sharing. Here you go, Jonah. How are you?
Good.
Did you have a good time?
Yeah.
What would you say was your favorite time or your favorite thing about camp? We'll get into some of the spiritual things, but what was your favorite? Oh, maybe it is spiritual. It doesn't have to be, you know, just fun, but. What was your favorite thing about camp? Ignore me eating my muffin.
I don't know. The sermons really got me. I really like that.
I'm not going to lie. That guy could preach, right?
Mm-hmm. That guy. Real good.
Yeah. So what was your favorite sermon? Yeah, the trash can one?
The trash can one. And then
that was a great one. Make an impact. Make a dent. Come
yeah.
on. Come on, somebody.
Make a dent.
All right. For those of you guys who don't know, there was a third sermon. For those of you guys who weren't there, the speaker spoke about like how we're in the darkness and most people who live in the world are rummaging around trash. Like we're trying to find, we're looking for things, but we're really just walking around in trash. And so he talked about leaving a dent. And so he grabbed this big trash can, metal trash can, and just grabbed a sledgehammer and just, like, pounded it. Good. Good, because you'll remember it for life. Yeah. Just like that. But seriously, guys, we were challenged to leave a dent in the gate, on the gates of hell, to leave a dent in the world. And so I hope you guys felt the same challenge because I felt it. I was like, I want my name to be on that dent, you know. And so what else did you feel like you came away from camp with?
Second sermon about doing things that need to be done instead of going with your feelings. I felt like that was really impactful, especially to me, because I feel like being me, my feelings tell me, just put it off until the last day, last minute. You can do it. You can do it last second, but there are some things that, you know, can't wait till the last second. Sometimes when you think, I'll just put it off to the last second. That last second come when the last second comes, you could be a bit too late. Like, I remember, I'm not sure. Someone told me about the pastor said it about his daughter's school, right?
Yep.
And someone got mono, and then their spleen ruptured. And they passed away as a teenager. And that was, a huge event for the entire school. And, you know, if you think about it, what if they weren't a Christian? They were popular. And what if they weren't a Christian? Then they didn't have a chance to meet Jesus. And unfortunately, they don't get to be in heaven with him. So if someone wanted to save them, it's too late. Bible puts that on us, so we need to save people. I've really felt that, we need to get the word out. We need to bring people to church before, you know, something like this happens again.
Yeah, amen. Now, I know that we had some great conversations. You and I, we had some great conversations after the altar, and we just talked just about that, right? About just that, bringing people, not just to church, but to Christ, right? And being people who stand up for Christ everywhere that we go. You know, that sermon seems to have really impacted you. Like, what's different now? What's different with Jonah now? You know, what's Jonah going to do that's different after Avalanche 2017?
Well, when I got back, there were two people I had Snapchat streaks with. And when I got back, I was like, yo, I just got back from this church camp. It was awesome. You should come to church sometime. And they said, and when they snapped me back, they were like, oh, I'm at a pretty bad church. Everyone hates each other, and we're actually looking for a new church.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, I told them. And I told them about the services. They're planning on coming Sunday. And they're going to bring their friend along, too.
That's awesome. Great. That's awesome, man. Man, I'm excited. I'm excited to see what God's going to do through you, man. It hasn't even been, a full week, and you already bring people to church. That's awesome. That's exciting, man. Is there anything else you want to say to everyone here?
Obviously go to Avalanche. Everybody needs to go to Avalanche. But
listen up.
Have a strong faith in God. Don't lose that. Statistics show 1 in 3 teenagers, after they leave high school, they don't go back to church. So don't lose your faith. Have a strong ground. And bring people to church. The church needs to grow in this nation, because we live in a very sinful nation. So I believe we need to stand firm and bring more people, because if we don't do that, then we're not going to be leaving a dent.
Leave a dent. I love it. I love it, guys. All right, man. Thank you very much. Can't wait to meet your friends. Make sure that you introduce your friends to everybody.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. Awesome. Anybody else? Anybody else want to step up? Yes, Anna. Nobody else. How you doing, Anna?
Pretty good. So, before we even went to Avalanche, I had some things that were on my heart and I wanted to say, but I really didn't know how to say them. There were all these thoughts in my head that were just like swirling around, and I didn't know how to put them into words. And that was really challenging for me. So when I went to Avalanche, what I was really praying for was God to just clear my path for me just to know what to say. And while I was at Avalanche, I ended up being given a verse, which was Hebrews 13, 1 through 3, which is, keep on loving each other as brothers and sisters. Don't forget to show hospitality to strangers. For some who have done this have entertained angels without realizing it. Remember those in prison if they were yourself. Remember those being mistreated as if you felt their pain in your own body. That is kind of what I've been wanting to talk about. I have been new so many times, and it's always been a challenge, and anyone who's been new knows that, and it's really difficult. And the thing is that today, people don't reach out to the new people. There's a lot of people who, if you go to a new school, they have these friends, and they don't open up to you. And at Avalanche, I ended up having an interesting conversation with a girl where she had been friends with these girls for a while. And at Avalanche, they ended up getting in some fight, and everyone turned against her. So she felt all alone, and she was just all by herself, and her friends were off on their own, kind of against her. And so I ended up talking to her, and I was like, well, is there anyone else in your youth group? And she told me about another girl, and she's like, oh, she's so annoying because she keeps on following us around, like trying to be your friend and like copying us. And that kind of hit me because I know that I've been that person. I've been this person who, there's been a point where people aren't coming to you, so you have to try to go to them. And that shouldn't be how it is, because if people are having to follow you around, then you're not doing your job as a Christian. You're not doing your job of going out and following them if they have to try so hard to try to be with you. Because God says that we accept others, that we are going to be there for them, and we're going to be their friends. And if they're all alone, if they're going to have to be hurting, and if they have to try so hard just to try to be around you, then God's looking down on us, and he's disappointed. Because that's not what we're supposed to be doing. And I realized that that is something that God has told me before, and I never even realized it. Because once upon a time, a while ago, I was sitting at the window over there, and all of a sudden, I looked out the window, and I kind of just, like, saw someone sitting out there just on the steps, like, torn apart and just in pain and all alone. And I thought it was just my imagination, but every time I came to church and I was near that window, that's all I could think about. And at Avalanche, it suddenly hit me, and I realized that is all the people in the world who are torn, and they're afraid to come into church. They sit outside of it because they're afraid to face God, and they don't have someone to bring them in and show them the confidence and just the pleasure of God. And they sit out there in pain. And I realized that it's my calling and everyone's just to be out there for them, to go and find them, not let them find us, but to find them and show them who God is and bring them into the church and show them there's nothing to be afraid of, even though our sin is great,
yeah,
that God can heal us. That's what I learned at Avalanche.
You're a preaching machine. Hold on to that mic for a little bit. Holy cow. Just drop it. No, don't drop it. I'm going to get in trouble. Oh, man. And I'm so excited, man. I'm excited that you came, and I'm excited that you started coming to a church and have stuck it out, because I know that being new is a challenge. And I've moved a lot of times, and so I know how that feels. But I truly, when I see you, I really feel like you have actually, I don't feel like it. I know that you have the gift of hospitality. You have the gift of making people feel welcome. And the gift of hospitality sometimes gets kind of like thrown aside as like a practical gift, right? Mm-hmm. But what it really is showing God's grace to people, right? God is gracious, and God invites us into his home. And so, and you are that, you are just that, you know, you take the command of us being called to the ministry of reconciliation, which is what you were just talking about, you know, reconciling the world with God.
person who's going to go out into the world and bring people into church and make them realize there's nothing to fear. Like, you know, God isn't angry at you, and neither are we. And so keep it up, you know, invite people. You have that in you, you know, you have that gift of hospitality. And not only do you have that in you, but wake it up in other people, you know. Like, let that light shine in you, and let that light be contagious and, you know, be awoken inside of other students that we have. So I encourage you, keep doing that. It's awesome. All right, give it up, guys. All right, somebody else, guys. Come on, don't all be scared. No fear. Oh, Ashlyn, all right. Listen, as she comes up, listen, we are for you, guys. Every single one of us, we are for you. We want to hear what you have to say. And I know sometimes there's like a little voice in your head that says, oh, sit down. Nobody wants to hear what you say. But listen, that's a lie, okay? We want to hear. We want you to share. We want to empower you. And we want to make sure you get an opportunity to tell everyone what God has done in your life. So, Ashlyn, how are you?
I'm good.
Good. What did God do this weekend in your life?
I kind of just wanted to share something that I shared with some of the girls that, like, after service in our, like, groups or whatever. But before Avalanche, God had just given me, like, a word that I felt was going to really be relevant to our whole experience at Avalanche. And he gave me the word that was surrender. Mm. And I really felt like, especially, like, with a lot of different things going on in my life as well as, like, some of my friends' lives, that it was, like, that it was really going to be a powerful experience. So I think it was the first night that we were there. We were just worshiping at the front, and out of the, like, the screen where all the words go when for the songs, there was, like, this chariot that came out of it, and it's there was angels inside of it, and the angels came out, and they surrounded all the edges of the sanctuary, and it split in half, and there was a gold road that came out of it. And so I felt like, and I just looked around at some of the people that were around me, and I just felt like that everybody was just kind of laying everything down. And so I really felt like that, kind of like what Brianna said during service, that like you can lay everything down like at the altar there and stuff. But when you come here, you not only have to lose that, you can't lose it, but you also have to go deeper.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really powerful that, you know, just because you're at Romney, New Hampshire, at Avalanche, and you feel like you're away from life, doesn't mean, like, that you can't feel like that here, too. That you can still worship wherever you are. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what conditions you're under. God can be wherever you want him to be and wherever you invite him to be. So that's kind of just what I felt like God wanted me to share.
Amen. That's awesome. Surrender. Man, that image, what do you remember what night it was?
That was the first night.
The first night. Well,
during
that's
worship.
Amazing way to start with a retreat.
That's cool.
Wow. Guys, give it up for Ashlyn. So proud of you guys who are coming up and speaking. I know it's a challenge for some of you, but you guys are doing great. Is there anyone else that would like to come up? I'm wondering if he's coming up. Anthony, come on up. Come on up, Anthony. You want to get up in the middle of service. Come on up. Come on, throw it out and come on up. We'll wait for you. We're all waiting for you. Come on, hurry up.
Tony.
Tony. Tony. Somebody grab him. All right, he's on deck. He's on deck. Somebody else. Yes, come on up. Tony, you're on deck. How are you, Brianna?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. I'm doing well. Great job with worship tonight.
Thank you. Hi.
So tell us something, tell us a little about Avalanche.
So before Avalanche, I kind of shared some of this with the girls, but I'll share it with you guys. Before Avalanche, God's really opened some big doors for me this year, which I think I kind of shared with you. I go to, for those of you who don't know, I go to a Christian school, and so the Lord's given me the opportunity to lead them in worship, and it's been a little bit rough just kind of waiting on God to, like, work in the students' lives. And, sorry.
So one thing, the last night when he was talking about making a dent, it really, really hit me because just all the brokenness that you see each and every day, you kind of ignore it. And his last point was talking about how nothing will ever happen if you don't spend time on your knees praying. And that kind of, you know, I've been thinking about, you know, how awesome it would be for the Lord to kind of start something in their hearts, but never realize that it takes an action on my part as well, praying for, as their worship leader, praying for their hearts as to prepare them for whatever God has. So it's kind of something that totally stuck out to me. So
yeah.
Sorry.
No, that's all right. It's good. It means it's heartfelt, what you're saying. To be honest, that's a big thing that stuck out to me too as a youth pastor, is the fact that we have a part to play.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says you have not because you ask not.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of times where we would probably see more students come to church and saved if we simply prayed. And the truth is that we don't pray enough, all of us. I'm not just talking about myself, but all of us. And there is a part of us that is involved in God's work, you know. And there's going to be some responsibility that's on our end, you know. And as we get to different places of leadership within our school, that sense of responsibility begins to grow inside of us. You know? So it's important for us to begin praying more and more for the people around us. And it makes a difference. And that's the way that we're going to make a difference here at the Forge. We're going to put a dent in Oxford and Seymour and Naugatuck and your school, you know, and we're going to do it through prayer and we're going to do it together. So is there anything else that you'd like to say about Avalanche or to maybe to some of these students here that went or didn't go?
Okay, well, Avalanche is awesome. If you didn't go, you really missed out. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Thanks. I don't know if I have anything to say. Jesus loves you. Have a great day.
We're making a video and we're going to end with that. Jesus loves you. Have a great day. I love it. Is anyone else? Anthony, Tony, come on up. Come on, man. Don't be scared. There's girls that came up. All right, you're right. I can't. That's sexist. You're right. Come on, Tony. Share. You got it. Come on up. Do it. You got it. You have something to share. I pull it out of you. Come on. Come on. Give it up for Tony! All right. Here you go, Tony.
He's my man, Volta.
All right. So, how was Avalanche?
It was good.
You got to speak into the mic. Use the mic.
It was amazing.
Yes. What was your favorite part of Avalanche?
I don't know.
Honest, genuine answer. All right, we'll take it. What was that? What was something that you would say that God did in your life? I could tell you one.
Go ahead.
No, I want you to answer first, and I'll tell you one.
I don't know. No clue.
All right, I got one for him. Ready? Second service, all right? It's nighttime. No, I have a mic. I have one. I'm good. Thank you. Appreciate it, though. Thank you for sharing.
Oh, no
he
problem.
Likes to share, obviously. He shared his muffin with me. He's a sharing kind of guy. Actually, by the way, and all jokes aside, Anthony, also known as Tony, is one of the greatest, like, one of the biggest servants I've ever met. Like, it doesn't matter what you're doing. If you're in the middle of doing something, he's going to be there and ask if he can help. So I appreciate your service.
Hey, Joe, you want to borrow these?
So, but actually, in all seriousness, your stepdad, right, has had heart problems.
Yep.
And in the middle of the second night, he just leaned over to me and he said, "Hey, I just want to let you know that my stepdad has gone back into the hospital because of heart problems." And we prayed for him, right, that same night.
Yes, sir.
And he was fine the next day. So anything to do with your heart is very sensitive. Like, you could, I mean, what he had is called the widowmaker, and it's a problem that happens with one of the valves in your heart. And most guys, okay, end up having pain in their arm or in their neck or in their jaw,
And don't go to the doctors because they're guys and they think that they're going to tough it out. Okay. And then they don't wake up. And so, but your mom really felt like he needed to go to get that checked out.
Yeah,
and
he's really stubborn. So, I don't know. His whole arm was black. Like, from where they put the, I think it's a catheter or something like that.
Yeah.
Where they put it was, like, black to where it was leading to his arm.
But he's fine now, right?
Yeah, he's all good.
Yeah. So, I mean, we got to pray for his stepdad, and he's all better now. His arm was black. No, it's not. So, but man, tell us something, man.
He's white again.
So tell us, man. What was something that got in your own heart at this avalanche? Did God do anything in your own heart specifically? Or did God challenge you in any way?
Challenge me to watch my mouth. Definitely. Last year's summer camp was crazy, though. That's about it.
Good. All right, guys. Give it up for Anthony. Tony, appreciate it. Thanks for coming up. Alex, come on up real quick. Guys, can you guys give it up for Alex? What up, man? I like your pants.
Thank you.
Dang, you're a guitar player through and through, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, so. Are you signed up for guitar? Pre-guitar lessons?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, you should sign up, yeah. Well, I'm not going to charge my family. So, anyways, all right. So, what was something that, actually, you signed up to Avalanche like a week before.
Oh, yeah.
Right, like a very last minute. We didn't, like, he showed up to, he just, like, showed up, and he was like, hey, can I come to Avalanche? And I was like, who are you? I was like, I don't even know your name. So, yeah. You got the paperwork in time. It was awesome, man. Did you have a good time?
Yeah, it was amazing.
Awesome. So. I'm glad to hear that. So, why don't you share some of your experiences at Avalanche? Why don't you share about that? What is that about?
Oh, yeah, so.
Share the story because not everyone here knows what happened.
Oh, okay. So basically, I really wanted a. So basically, I really wanted a Chewbacca onesie for Christmas for like 2 straight months. Then I finally got one, so I basically wear it almost every day. And but I wash it. I wash it. So then I decided I wanted to go ice skating in it, so I just packed it up, and then I went ice skating in it.
Awesome, awesome. That was hilarious.
So,
that's great, that's great. I love your spirit, man. I love that you're, like, not afraid to be you, and that's awesome, that's awesome. But what's something that that really impacted you from Avalanche, man? Maybe a service or something?
Yeah, definitely the ending service on Saturday.
Making an impact?
Yeah, that one was definitely.
Do you feel challenged in any way? Like now, like, you know, like I asked Jonah, what's different now? Like what, you know, with Alex, what is Alex doing different now that he's come back from Avalanche?
I mean, I definitely feel like I have a relationship with God, like, well, closer than what it used to be. So I definitely feel like.
That's awesome. That's awesome. You have a certainty that you're going to heaven.
I hope.
Well, if you believe in Jesus Christ, then the answer is yes. It's really that simple. And that's all you have to do. So that's exciting, man. And is there anything else you'd like to say about Avalanche?
Well, it was amazing. It was an amazing time. I mean, definitely, like, retreats are probably one of the best ways to get to, like, know people. So.
Did you get to know these awesome people?
Yeah.
Yeah? Awesome. You guys get to know him? Yeah. Awesome, guy. All right, can you guys give it up for Alex real quick? I think we got time for two mas. Yes. Shay Shay. How you doing, Shaylin?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well.
So.
You even sit like your mom.
I just am my mom, okay?
I know, it's funny. I love it. So tell me, how was Avalanche for you?
It was awesome. It always is. You know, going on retreats is like my favorite thing to do with this youth group because it's where you really get to connect with other people and grow closer to God and grow closer to them in the process. And, you know, it's just like everybody is just real. Mm. It's just real life. You're doing life together, and that's the best part about it to me.
That's awesome. What big takeaway are you leaving Avalanche 2017 with?
Okay, so going into Avalanche, I just really wanted to be, like, refreshed. Like, you know, I don't know if you guys know, but doing Dependent Daughters, where I write devotionals twice a week, it can be very spiritually draining. And I have a very difficult time, like, balancing life, that, and, like, my personal spiritual devotions, like, finding time for that, because when I'm in my word, I find myself being like, oh, that's a good thing to write about for Dependent Daughters. I'm like, no, I need to be looking in the word for me. And so going to Avalanche was just kind of like, in my mind, I'm like, I'm going to focus on God for me. This is for me. And the funny thing is, every sermon was about others. And I realized that even though, yes, I do need to be focused on me personally, like spiritually on a day-to-day basis, I kind of was selfish going into Avalanche, thinking that I needed everything to, like, help me, and I really needed to be focused on others and, like, the people around me who were hurting. And my favorite thing that happened at Avalanche was the last night service.
That was good.
Where they were talking about the dents. He said, make dents with your mouth, with your hands, and on your knees. And all of us, one of those things are going to be our weaknesses. One of us aren't going to have it easy to talk about God. One of us aren't going to have it easy to serve and give with our money or be praying. One of those areas somebody is going to struggle with. And I struggle with more than one of them for sure. But the one thing he challenged us to do that particular night was at least do number three on our knees. And so the altars were flooded. Like, I get so happy when I see all my peers, like just crying out for other peers. That just makes my heart so happy. And they were all at the altars, and he said, on the count of three, we're going to go on our knees. And he counted to three, and on three, the whole place just dropped, like, weeping. Like, I just couldn't stop crying. It was just so, like, beautiful. And being a homeschooler, I don't have very many opportunities to easily, like, make dents. You know I can, and I just don't have very many exposure to people outside of people who already know the Lord. And I do get to invest in people and help them grow alongside with God, but I've never had the opportunity to lead someone to the Lord, and that's something that's really been my desire for some years now. And I just realized that I need to start praying for that person to come into my life, that I need to start praying for their heart this far in advance, and not just praying that, like, so I can say I've led someone to the Lord. Praying for their soul to come, and that their soul would be ready for the moment when I'm going to be able to do that someday. And it was just really eye-opening to, like, be convicted of that and be reminded that I need to have my priorities straight. So.
That's awesome. That's awesome. You make a dent with your mouth, with your hands, and with your knees, man. That I remember that really hit me hard. And you're right. There's always going to be one that's going to be, you know, a weakness of ours. And maybe not a weakness, but one that will always be weaker than the others, you know. And we have to make efforts to make sure that isn't the case, you know, because it's easy to get complacent. It's easy to just say, I go to youth group, I go to church, or, you know, I go to retreats, and yeah, every once in a while, people know I'm Christian, so that should be enough, you know. And it's easy to do that and to get really complacent and not strive to speak about Jesus, not strive to help others and meet people's needs so that you can tell them about God or you know, get on your knees and say, oh, well, I did my 5-minute devotional today, so I don't need to pray anymore. And, you know, praying for this person doesn't really fit in this time slot that I have. So, you know, we have to constantly be putting ourselves into a place where we're like, okay, how can I do better? How can I really, you know, seek to do that more? And it's great that you're feeling like you need to save, you know, or speak to someone about, and lead someone to Christ, rather. That's probably the best word or the best way to say it, because Like, I feel like we all need that. Like, we all need to have that urgency, right, of saying, God, like, I want to lead one more person. Like, I want to lead one more person. I don't want to preach, and I think we have time for one more after this, but one of my favorite movies is Schindler's List. Anyone ever seen it? It's definitely not a teenager or kid movie. Okay, that movie will rock your life. It's about the Holocaust, so unless you're really, you know, ready to, like, cry a lot, don't watch it. But there's a part in which it's the end of the war, right? And he's walking out, and all these Jews are around him, all the people that he saved, and they're all really happy that he's there and he saved all of them because it's the end of the war. But he looks at his pin and he realizes, I could have saved one more if I just traded this and like bought somebody else to work for my factory. He looks at his car and he says, there's 10 more, like right here. And he starts looking around. He starts realizing, he's like, there's two more right here. And he starts looking around. He's just like, this right here, they would have given me at least five. If not five, at least three, you know. And every time I see that scene, it makes me like leak courage everywhere, right? I just, we don't cry, we leak courage. And I just leak tons of courage. But the reason is because I don't want to get to heaven and say, God, I could have done more. I could have like reached those two people in my chemistry class. I could have reached that person in my bus stop. I could have reached that person in my swim team. I could have reached that person in my math class. Like, you know, I don't want to be that person. I don't want you to be that individual. So that's a great reminder. You know, let us be mindful and intentional and purposeful about the people around us and trying to really lead their soul to Christ. Guys, give it up for Shaylin. Jonathan? All right, come on up, Jonathan.
All right.
How you doing?
Good.
Good. You were really excited to come up.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, great. So how was Avalanche, man? Tell us something.
It was great. I mean, God really, like, spoke to me. Yeah. He, like, I just felt like I grew so much closer to him. And, like, all the service just, like, impacted me. Like, they were great. Like, and before I came to Avalanche, I was struggling, like, in my, like spiritual life. Like, I wasn't really living for God. And I feel like now I really do have that security that, like, I am going to go to heaven. And that God, I do have Jesus in my heart.
So what's Jonathan after Avalanche 2017? How is he different?
Well, I'm definitely going to stand up for my faith, and because I've had multiple chances to share my faith, but I haven't took that opportunity. So I'm praying that God will help me to be bold and to step up.
Guys, give it up for Jonathan. Is there anything that you would like to just tell your family or your friends here for?
Definitely just make sure you don't fall away from God, because it's really hard getting back on the right track.
I love you, man. Such a tender heart. I love it. the feels, though. Felt courage just like well up in my heart. I was like, holy cow. Whew. All right, man. Jonathan, that was a great reminder. Seriously. It is easier to fall off, and it's harder to get back on. So, and yet, very simple. Sometimes all we have to do is ask God to forgive us, and it's as easy as that. So, I believe we have time for one last one. So, is there? All right,
right, maybe we can do two. All right, Matt, hurry up, run up here. How you doing, Matt?
Good.
What's something that happened to Avalanche?
Well, I really felt like during the last night, God said, like, making a dent in the wall of hell, like, it really spoke to me, like, how much Christians, like, no, non-Christians die, like, each year and don't get to go into heaven. Instead, they're burning in the pits of hell. So, instead of that, like, I was, like, feeling really bummed, like, during that message. Like, instead of taking away good, I was, like, taking away bad. But then, during, like, the prayer time, I was, like, praying. And then I saw, like, I would just, like, take a second and just look around. And I just saw everyone around us and just them praying. And I was like, God, do you see all this? Do you see all these people? Do you see all these people praying for you, Lord? And God just really spoke to me. Like, there might be a lot of people going to hell, but there's a lot of people going to heaven too. So that just put me, that just got in my heart.
It encouraged you.
Amen. Yeah.
Amen. Anything else you'd like to say to everyone here?
Nah, that's pretty much it.
All right. Nah. I love this guy. All right, David Brezina, you wanted to come up? Mr. Brezina, here you go.
Thank you.
How was Avalanche?
It was good. Fun.
What was your biggest takeaway from Avalanche?
Well, I don't know how I'm going to follow what the other two said, but definitely going off what Jonathan said, before Avalanche, I definitely felt like, I've always had a relationship with God my whole life, but I definitely felt like it was getting further and further away before Avalanche, and I feel like Avalanche just hit that, like, that reset button, you know, like got me back up there and let me. Now it's allowing me to, hey, you know, it's not all lost. Amen. Keep going.
Awesome. That's right. We do hard things. Awesome. What's one thing that you're like, man, I have to do different now that I know, or after Avalanche?
I just got to stop doing, like, the stuff that brought me away in the first place. Got to clear my act. And that definitely, like, showed me how, and, like, showed me why I have to do it. But someone else, Pastor Clark.
Yes, that's
maybe. Okay. I'm on a roll. Definitely something else that he said that stuck with me. He just, like, slid in. I want to say it was sometime Saturday. I don't know which one. It was about how have a friend there, or one of your best friends, that is close with God. It will keep you on track. And I don't feel like I've been lacking that the past couple of months. Like, I've just been, like, this weird state and haven't really had anybody close to me that's also close to God. You know, my sisters, but, you know,
yeah.
They're sisters. So that definitely made me realize, hey, you know, some of the friends who I do see every day or that I do talk to, some of the friends that are, like, still, like, active and major part of my life, I talk to them, see, and I have asked a couple kids. I've been trying to get kids here for months, but, you know, that doesn't work.
Keep trying.
And like, I found out, like, oh, hey, you're close to God, too. And, like, just some kids who, you know, wouldn't guess, found out who were close to God, and, like, now I feel like I'm steering back on track.
Awesome. Hey, hold on. This guy's just, like, dying to leave. He doesn't like the stage. That's right. Listen, man, I just really feel my heart, man, like, that God's going to do some awesome things in your school through you. Like, he's rising up to be a leader, and I just really feel that deep in my heart right now, you know. And some of it's going to be through friendships, but some of it's going to be through standing opposite of what other people stand for, you know. But you're going to have to know who you are in order to be able to do that and to be in that situation to say, that's not who I am, and that's not what I'm about, you know. So just wanted to let you know that, man. I really think that God, like, keep just those people you keep inviting to church, you know, and keep telling about Jesus, keep doing it. Keep telling about Jesus. Keep inviting them to church, and you'll see that over time, maybe not now, maybe not even in high school, but maybe after high school, after they graduate, you know, maybe they'll contact you and be like, hey, you remember that? You just just wouldn't stop telling me about Jesus. You know, like I started going to church, or, you know, you never know what could happen. You never know what God's going to do with the seeds that you plant in there. So we're just called to be steadfast and to be faithful. So just keep doing that. All right? All right. What? Okay. All right. Give it up for Jaina.
Hey.
Parents are going to kill me, but go ahead.
Oh, okay. All right. So raise your hand if you're from Seymour High School.
Let's go.
Okay, well, you graduated, so. I know, you're right. Okay, so raise your hand if, what? Raise your hand. Okay, Shelby gave me this idea, and Aiden was about to start a Christian club before he graduated at Seymour High School. So Shelby kind of mentioned it to me, and raise your hand if you would want to get involved in a Christian club at your school. At
one,
any, at
two,
any school,
three,
at
four,
any
five,
school
six,
you
seven,
are
eight,
in.
8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Yeah, so I really think that we're going to start that, and I really am excited. So you guys should, too, at your schools.
Wait, hold on. That's like, you can't just drop that bomb and then walk away like here's the mic. So
that's what I wanted to say.
So you're going to start a Bible club?
Oh, yeah, me and Shelby.
Awesome. Yeah. That's great. Great news. That's exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. Listen, if you're from Seymour High School, all right, I want to see you guys at this Bible club. You guys are supporting this all the way. You don't have a choice, all right? Family helps family. That's it. But listen, if you guys need anything, please let us know. Please let the rest of this youth group know. We want to be able to
I
be
hope
there.
It just falls through because they were going to let you do it, right? Oh, okay, yeah.
Awesome.
That's
fun. The road work has been laid out by Aiden, so.
Thanks, Aiden.
Yeah.
Real MVP.
That's awesome. Guys, give it up for Jaina. Yes. You want to come up? I'll help you guys both. Come on, hurry up. To Mrs. Wendy can come up anytime she wants.
All right, guys.
Hey.
Hi. Okay, so at camp, there was one sermon. I believe it was the first one on the second day about the blind beggar Bartimaeus, Mark 10, 46 through 58?
I don't remember.
It's one of those.
I have a Bible.
Scripture, right? And it was talking about how a lot of Christians, we go around and we go from person to person shaking this cup, asking for things like acceptance and love. And, you know, as someone who used to struggle with depression, I used to know that feeling of always shaking that cup. And at camp, during, let's say, a weird time, during one of the worship sessions, it was just like, this overfilling, this overflow of just joy. And I remember talking to my boys about it. They remember because I was giggling like an idiot over at, by the altar. It's okay. You guys can say I was. But it was just a weird feeling. And I want to encourage you guys, if you guys ever feel like you're just shaking your cup, asking for something, to just go to God. Because just remember that, and Pastor Clark said this, that people are just going to give you their spare change. But God's going to be the one that's going to fill up your cup and keep it going. He's going to keep filling it.
The overflow.
So, the overflow, exactly. And, you know. So that's just something I wanted to say. And, you know, from the boys over in other churches. I saw, dude.
Is there any other leader that didn't want to come up? Did you? Yeah. Give it up for Amanda.
Hello.
The Mrs. Sousa.
Hi. All right. So I actually, Avalanche is really special. It's really rare for me that I don't have to be up on the stage leading worship where I get to just like worship myself. And so these retreats, Avalanche, and the summer camps lately have been a place for me to be able to do that. And last year at Avalanche, God gave me my first vision. And this year, at the altar time Saturday night, I went up to the altar and I was praying over a student, and I'm not going to say who, and I really felt like God gave me a small word for them, and that was the first time that happened for me too. And kind of like, I believe it was Ashlyn who said the word surrender was really heavy on her heart, and that was the word. I'm not going to, again, go into detail about the student, the word that the God gave me for the student, but it was just, you know, that God wanted the student to not half surrender, but to wholly surrender with her entire heart, her whole being, to surrender to God. And that was when things were going to truly change. So that was really cool, just for God to give me that first word. And I, you know, I just wanted to encourage you guys, just as Pastor JC said earlier, how you guys are like the most unified youth group that, at least I think, ever that I've ever seen. But it's so true. And, you know, and I try to, you know, tell you girls all the time, and guys too, I guess, you guys are cool too, but like the whole youth group, you guys are seriously so awesome and so special, and I truly consider it a privilege and an honor to be a leader, a friend, like a big sister figure, I guess, to you guys. And we all the leaders, we all love you, and it's just awesome to get to be able to grow closer to you guys at Avalanche. So yeah, I guess that was all. So keep following Jesus with everything that you have wholeheartedly, and yeah, love
Amen.
You guys.
Amen. Feel that. She can't do the jump. She can't make the jump.
This is my first time going. And I loved it. What some of you guys, well, none of you guys probably know this, but JC and I had one thing after another, just some demonic attacks in our personal lives, right before we took you guys. And on the bus ride there, there were a couple things that were jarring, just the demonic attacks. And I sat there thinking, like, I mean, God, I know that this is going to be something important and special, but that particular circumstance was really overwhelming. And so JC and I, the whole ride up there, we just prayed for you guys. And over this weekend, I think probably the biggest thing that was that God did for me was sitting watching everything that he did for you guys. And all of a sudden, I realized, I'm like, all of those things that the devil was trying to do, he didn't accomplish. None of them were, you know, sometimes when you're overseeing a group of people, the devil tries to get to you because you're the one that is facilitating this, and we were really feeling it strongly, and it was so beautiful. I think one of the nights that was so beautiful, I think somebody said it was when he said, on the count of three, I want you guys just to hit your knees. And I just thought, like, I mean, you guys have no idea how powerful what you did that night really was. I mean, you guys, you crossed over from the natural and you went into the supernatural and you stood in the gap for people. That's what you did, and that's powerful. And the devil doesn't want that to succeed. He doesn't want you to know that you have the ability to do that. So there was a lot of really beautiful moments. That same night, JC and I, again, we stood there together praying for you guys. And I think, you know, I told the girls this, and I'll share it with everybody, but up until this past month, I have just been JC's girlfriend, and I have been coming and serving, but it was the fiancé now. But it was really the first time that God really spoke to my heart personally, like, these belong to you, and I handpicked you to be here. And so it just was an ownership in my heart for you guys. God really just filled my heart with a lot of love for you. And I'm just really excited, and I feel very honored because your guys' lives are so important and special and precious. So, yeah. Love you guys.
All right, guys, I'm going to invite you to stand up real quick. I hope that you've enjoyed these testimonies, the opportunity to share and to just draw close as a family. If you weren't able to make this Avalanche trip, we have a whole bunch of other stuff coming up. Every trip is important to us, not because of what we're doing, but because we're going together, right? And together means a lot to me specifically. But I know that it will make a difference in your life if you're part of a group that's striving together to be more like Christ. So, and the last thing that I'd like to say to you guys is go out and make a dent. You know, we call the gospel the good news. That's really the word gospel means good news. And we call it the good news, but it's only good news if it makes it there in time. Like, it's only good news if people hear about it before they pass away. And the truth is like, we're not Superman. We're not immortal, you know, and life is short, you know. And so I encourage you, you've come back from Avalanche, or even if you haven't come back from Avalanche, tell people about the goodness of Christ. Go to your schools tomorrow. Like, wake up. Have your knees hit the floor. Pray for an opportunity to tell someone about Jesus and to invite them to youth group. Invite them to the Forge. Invite them to Sunday morning services. Make a difference. Leave an impact, not only in your schools, but in your families and everywhere that you go. Believe that God wants to do something, because he does. God wants to reach your schools more than you do. God wants to save your friends more than you do. God has a burden for them more than you have. And so I just encourage you, like, tomorrow, let's go after it. Jaina and Shelby, you guys are starting a Bible club. We are 100% behind you. If somebody else wants to start a Bible club, like, let me know. We will make it happen at your school. Like, I don't care what it takes. I don't care. I have friends in high places, all right? Jesus is my friend, all right? So we're gonna make it happen. Seriously, we're going to make it happen. But let's make a difference. Life is too short to just aim low and not make a difference. Life is too short to not tell people about Jesus. So I encourage you to do that, guys. Life is short. You won't always be around the people that you're around right now. People move. People pass away, sadly. But it's just a reality of things. So let's start by praying for them. And then secondly, let's start by telling them about Jesus and inviting them to church. So let's bow our heads real quick. We're going to pray. And then we're going to get ready to head on out of here. God, I thank you, Lord, for the Forge Student Ministry. I thank you, God, that you've called us to do hard things, Lord. I thank you, God, that you've called us to persevere, God, and to put ourselves in positions, God, where we can tell people about your goodness. I thank you, God, that you've strategically put each and every one of these students, Lord, in different schools, God, and in different classes, God, to be able to have an impact where they go to school. I pray that you would give them a burden to share the gospel, that you would give them a burden, Lord God, to tell people about you and your goodness and the fact that there is life to be had, and more than life, abundant life, Lord. God, I thank you, God, that you've called these students, God, to wake people up, Lord Jesus, from darkness to light, to bring people, God, from the rummaging of trash, God, to living in a mansion, Lord, that you have for us in heaven. God, I thank you, God, that you've equipped these students, God, with all that they need to be able to make a difference and to leave an impact in this world. God, I just pray right now, Lord God, that you would empower each and every one of these students, that you would embolden them, that you would give them faith to believe, God, in miracles and in the impossible, and that you would give them the courage, Lord Jesus, to be a beacon of light everywhere that they walk, Lord. God, I just send these students forth, God, tonight. And I pray that just like Jonah has already invited two people, I pray that each and every one of these students, God, would invite 2, 3, 4, 5 different people, God, to come next week, God, to come on Sunday, that they would begin praying for the food, God, in hopes of people asking them what they're doing, God, and that they would share the gospel right there and then, God. And I pray right now that you would give them the boldness to start Bible clubs everywhere that they go. I pray that we would see a revival in this youth group, and not only in this youth group, but in these towns, God, in Oxford, in Seymour, God, in all of Connecticut, Lord God. And I pray that it would be done through these teenagers. I pray that you would raise up a generation that will stand in the gap for their friends and for their family, Lord God, who do not know you, Lord. God, I pray that there would be a great harvest, Lord. It says in your word, God, that the harvest is ready. We are in need of workers. We are in need of leaders. We are in need of people who are unafraid and who are willing to put their reputation on the line. God, I ask all of this in your mighty name, Lord. God, I pray it is you, God, who gives the increase. So I just pray right now that you would bring that burden to our heart, that would be our number one goal this year, God, and for the rest of our lives, God, that we would share the gospel so that many lives would be saved, Lord. I pray all of this in Jesus' name. And if your heart agrees, say aloud, amen. Amen. Awesome. All right, guys, I'll see you guys next week, next Tuesday. Do not forget to sign up for Project 333, because we're going to raise the money with, well, we're only going to do it with you, so sign up.